Hi, I'm Stephen Chu. I'm a professor of psychology here at Samford University in Birmingham, Alabama. This is the third in a series of five videos on the cognitive principles of effective teaching. In this video, I discuss the importance of prior knowledge in learning. Prior knowledge refers to what students believe or know about a topic before we teach it. Students come to us not as blank slates, but with a mix of accurate information and misconceptions, and both of these influence learning. Finally, I'm going to discuss the importance of effective learning strategies for long-term learning. One of the strongest predictors of student learning is their prior knowledge about a topic. The research is clear. The more students know about a topic, the easier it is for them to learn new information about it. People with a lot of expertise in an area, say a big sports fan, can easily learn new information related to their sport and learn it much faster than a novice. We often assume that learning is fastest and easiest when we know very little about a topic. But actually, that's when learning is most difficult and painstaking. That's why students often struggle more in introductory courses when they have no background than they do when they take advanced courses when they can rely on their prior knowledge. But prior knowledge is a double-edged sword. For most students, their prior knowledge is a mix of accurate information, simplistic information, misconceptions, and gaps in understanding. Students don't know which kind of information is which and where the gaps are. Inaccurate prior knowledge impedes new learning. Furthermore, useful prior knowledge isn't just knowing facts, it's having the facts organized in an appropriate framework or schema. One of the challenges of any introductory course is to overcome erroneous misconceptions and replace them with a useful schema. A schema is an organized framework of knowledge. This initial schema will not be as detailed as an expert's, but it should be accurate in key respects that will allow the student to apply it in a generally productive way. A good schema is generative. It allows students to set up accurate expectations about events, to recognize key pieces of information, and interpret a situation meaningfully. Finally, a good schema lays the foundation for further learning by generating questions and connecting new information to their existing knowledge. There are many ways that information can be organized. For example, students whose knowledge about writing is organized to support creative writing may struggle when asked to write a technical report. Also, in psychology, students who study classical conditioning as a historical phenomenon may have difficulty in recognizing everyday examples. One other important aspect of schema is they have to be activated to be useful. Consider this classic experiment by Bransford and Johnson. Read the following paragraph and think about how well you understand it and how easy it would be for you to learn. Most people find the paragraph hard to comprehend and have great difficulty in remembering it, unless they figure out the paragraph is about washing clothes. Try reading the paragraph again, keeping in mind that it's about washing clothes. It's much easier to understand and to remember the details because your schema allows you to interpret the passage. But that's not the key point of this study. Bransford and Johnson ran the study with three conditions. One group was not given the topic at all, one group was given the topic before reading the passage, and one group was given the topic after reading the passage. Take a look at the results for comprehension, the blue bars, and recall, the red bars. Being given the topic before reading certainly aided performance compared to the no topic control group, but look at how the topic after group did. They really did no better than the no-topic control group. Teachers need to be sure to activate the key schematic knowledge for their students before presenting information. Simply giving students a lot of information to organize for themselves won't work. Some teachers assume that students will remember the key points from the last lecture. This is not an effective learning strategy. To quote Bransford and Johnson, "In order for prior knowledge to aid comprehension, it must become an activated semantic context." Misconceptions are part of prior knowledge that can interfere with learning. Misconceptions occur in every field, and they're highly resistant to correction. They come from many sources. Some are part of popular culture, and they are spread and reinforced by the general public and the media. Like the misconception that we use only 10% of our brain capacity, or that people who are blind develop supersensitive hearing to compensate. Some misconceptions are intuitively appealing, or the result of naive beliefs. Some misconceptions are beliefs that people want to be true or feel should be true. Teachers should be aware that misconceptions can easily occur in their classrooms when students misunderstand what the teacher says or what the textbook says. Regardless of their source, misconceptions can be very difficult to change, especially when they're linked to student beliefs and values. Methods to correct misconceptions usually involve activating that misconception, then actively refuting it. However, the research is also clear that once the students leave your class, there's a good chance that the misconception may reassert itself. Teachers must always be aware of critical misconceptions and work to correct them. Once teachers have equipped students with an effective schematic understanding, they need to help students to retain this information through the use of effective learning strategies. The learning strategy that students prefer to use are typically the least effective for long-term recall, such as mindlessly rereading material, memorizing isolated facts, or massing study right before an exam. These strategies are easy to do and intuitively appealing, but they simply increase false confidence without increasing long-term learning. Students often avoid deeper learning strategies because they take longer and they're more effortful, even though they do result in better long-term learning. I've discussed deeper learning strategies in my How to Study videos, but let me summarize the 4 points of deeper learning here. Deep learning strategies involve elaboration. How does this concept relate to other concepts? Distinctiveness. What are the key differences between this concept and other concepts? Personal. How does this concept relate to students' own experiences? Appropriate to retrieval and application. How are students expected to use and apply this concept? Deep learning strategies involve some or all of these characteristics. Teachers can help students by designing activities that promote deep processing, or by explaining the principles of deep processing for their students, or modeling deep processing through use of examples. Effective teachers don't just teach content, they teach how to think about and learn that content. Once students have learned information, we want them to apply that information in novel contexts outside of our classes. This is called transfer of learning, and it doesn't happen easily. In fact, it probably won't happen unless teachers intentionally prepare students to do it. For example, in introductory psychology, students learn about deep processing, but they often do not apply these principles to their own studying. New learning is highly context dependent. When students learn a new concept, they associate it with a specific teacher, specific examples, specific class, and a specific course. The only purpose students see for learning information is to do well on the exam, after which it can be forgotten. When students fail to generalize learning, the learning is inert. Teachers typically underestimate how challenging it is to get students to transfer learning. They need to be shown how the general principle applies beyond the specific context in which it was learned. Teach students how to recognize when a concept is applicable so that they will be reminded of it outside the classroom context. Prior knowledge plays a major role in what students do or do not learn, and the likelihood of them using this information after they leave our courses. In the next video, I want to talk about some of the major constraints on people's ability to attend to and think about information.